know, it's so rare with any band that you've got this sort of even distribution of talent. Most bands have one talented guy or girl in them, maybe two. You know, this was a band of which all five members contributed something very, very unique.
They were doing things with harmonies again that it almost didn't feel like they needed to blend octaves. You felt that they just sang in unison and their voices were so distinct that they just automatically went into the right place.
Jim and John have such an amazing ability of harmonizing together. It's almost like they should have done this their whole lives or something like that, you know? I can't believe it's only their first record. They already have this great sense of a natural singing ability together, and the songs are so strong, and the band is so strong. I would imagine that it all, I mean, in a perfect world, it should go quite large.
Startling. They had the thrift store styling, totally anti-fashion, with the threadbare sweaters and the awful shirts. And they obviously had it.
Incredibly exciting if you knew Rudy Pop and you knew you can and you knew Captain Beefheart, because it seemed to have the same thing going on, this crunching together of strange rhythms and odd shafts of sound just sort of cutting against it like bits of glass.
I always remember that first time seeing Goldheart Assembly up in top of Great Portland Street, and it was the harmonies that got me, but it was all this instrumentation as well. And then I got the first record, but especially on the new record, the sounds on there, it's quite cinematic, it's quite wide in its scope and its breadth.
When Jim came into the studio, he had never recorded before. This was the first time. I didn't know what he was going to be like, and my favorite vocal microphone is a Telefunken U47. And I showed it to him. I said, "This is going to be your mic." And he froze. And he said, "That's great." I said, "Why is that?" He said, "That's the mic that Frank Sinatra sings in." That's when I realized that he was a big fan of Frank Sinatra's. He loved crooners. He liked Bing Crosby, like Elvis, all the crooners.
He just had a natural, good voice. You know, he could kind of do anything with it, you know. And it just developed really fast.
This is a great example of Jim crooning through the U47 and a very sweet, young voice.
Out into the snow, far from the tracks, the winter's children on our backs.
John would come in each, the end of the session, each evening. He'd have a go at the vocal. I'd have to drop in at that point, and he would go for the vocal because it was really raw on his voice. He'd do the screaming, and it'd always have to be at the end of the night because, you know, after that he couldn't do anything. He'd lose his voice. You know?
Wonderful.
It's very important to him that he actually does put what he's writing in the song into the way he's singing it. I mean, that's what makes a good singer. If it's Dylan or if it's John or if it's anybody, that's how a good singer has to sing.